That's true. After a while, he couldn't control him, and that's when Humphrey would go on suspension. And when he got off suspension, he only got the part of the Maltese Falcon because George Raft said, this is not a serious movie. It's been made twice before. He was quite right. And besides, this is a kid who's directing it. John Huston, never heard of him before. I'm not going to be in this movie. So, as John Huston said, I fell heir to Humphrey and was duly grateful.
Yeah. Prior to that, though, it was Luella Parsons who got Humphrey off a suspension.
It's interesting that she would take to him because he really was quite a snarling person. He was not easy to get to know. But for some reason, she took a shine to him, as did her rival, Hedda Hopper. I don't know what it was, but I think it's probably his just plain honesty.
Yeah.
He wasn't phony in any way.
Huston and Humphrey Bogart have quite a relationship.
They do. I think with the Maltese Falcon, it really showed what Huston was capable of. I mean, he used all the dialogue from the book, but somehow it's magic. And the end, which never worked in the other movies, which is Sam Spade is a really, as a womanizer and not a pleasant one, ends in this case with him turning over the love of his life and going on with the cops and giving them the money that he's supposed to be bribed with and all that. And I think the book, it was such a success. The book was a success, and then this movie of the three was such a success that I think Humphrey came to trust Huston. And in the end, you know, toward the other part of his life when he was making The African Queen, Humphrey Bogart's idea of going out of town was to go 3 miles out to Catalina Island on his boat.
Yeah.
Suddenly he went to Uganda. He said, the monster wants me to go to Africa. But it was a monster sacré, and he did what he should have done and got an Academy Award out of it.
Yes, he did. And along with him, though, was Katharine Hepburn, and magic was on that film.
It's interesting because Katharine Hepburn was sick throughout the making of the film. You know, she didn't have eyes for Humphrey Bogart. She had eyes only for Spencer. But she was a urologist's daughter, and that's another reason why she and Humphrey got along, because they were both children of physicians. And she did what urologists tell you to do, which is to stay hydrated all day long. So she would drank the bottled water and was sick as a dog because it really wasn't bottled water. Somebody had phonied it up and it was just tap water. Whereas Humphrey brushed his teeth, as did Huston, with beer and drank whiskey. Yeah. And they were healthy throughout the whole thing. So that's a lesson to your audience.
The other part of that is if you're going to drink water, drink bubble water because they can't refill bubble water into that same...
I hadn't thought of that. That's genius. That's good. I'm glad you told me that.
Having been there, and my husband had a direct there, that's what we learned.
Oh, and you were healthy throughout?
Yeah.
Good for you.
Not a problem. Good. Now, the great movie of all time, Casablanca. And in this corner is...
Oh, Humphrey Bogart, Ingrid Bergman, and Michael Curtiz.
Yeah.
Michael Curtiz was a Hungarian director who had several great successes with Errol Flynn, but was hardly Mr. Subtle or Mr. Romantic, and indeed had such a heavy accent that he said to his assistant at one point, get me a poodle for this, and they went out and got him a black curly-haired dog. He said, no, poodle, you know, water in the street, a poodle.
Yeah.
So that's what it was like on the set, plus the fact that they had no ending.
Yeah.
Ingrid Bergman said, who do I go off with? We don't know yet. Well, how can I look with loving eyes at Paul Henri when I'm next supposed to look loving? It was all very tough for them. And she said about Bogart, I kissed him, but I never knew him. He was going through the writhing through the last days of Mayo Metho, so it was not a good time for him. And yet what you saw in that film was a man very pained about choosing a life, giving up, the woman that he loved and going off to fight the war. And it occurred just at the right time because President Roosevelt and Winston Churchill left their homes. No president had ever gone from the United States in wartime and met in Casablanca, which had fallen to the Allies. So the next week, Casablanca this, Casablanca that, all the headlines, just as the movie came out. So it was phenomenal. But it was also a very good movie.
I also didn't know that the song, You Must Remember This, was from another...
It wasn't from another movie, it was from a stage show.
Yeah.
And it was by a man named Herman Hopfield, who never did anything else except tuba songs. And Max Steiner, who did the score, hated it. He hated the song. He hated the idea that he'd have to orchestrate it. But he did, and it turned out to be truly one of the great orchestral suites that he ever wrote. First of all, it's about wars. It's about love. It's about glory. All of those words took off at that point. Plus the fact, this is something that I think is not recognized enough, and that everybody in that movie, with the exception of Humphrey Bogart, and of course Dooley Wilson, who sang the song, has a foreign accent.
Yeah.
So they really were refugees. I mean, Peter Lorre was a refugee. You know, Sidney Greenstreet, all these people who seemed to be at a loss, and here they were waiting for the letters of transit, really were like that. They had relatives in Europe who never got those letters and who died in the Holocaust. So there was very much a kind of feeling of stress, tension, and romance within that film.
But the same group of foreigners in Beat the Devil don't make it.
Well, I don't think they make it. It's become a camp favorite, but Humphrey Bogart said, you know, and it's true, there are the same kind of people. You have Peter Lorre in there with an Irish name, O'Hara. You know, it's very much, it's a weird Crewman Capote script and made it up as he went along. Bogart said, only phonies think it's funny. Now, I don't know that that's the case, but he always hated it.
Yeah.
Didn't make any money for years and years and years. And yet, even there, Humphrey Bogart is front and center because it's the first camp movie.
Yeah.
So somehow he always manages to be a part of the zeitgeist, wherever it is.
I have to say that you say that people weren't that crazy. I loved Barefoot Contessa. I mean, it's truly, a fairy tale, and it's what people, you know, Cinderella, Sleeping Beauty, Barefoot Contessa.
Well, you are part of the film industry, and so you know the inside story. And you know, Joe Mankiewicz is telling a lot of stories about Rita Hayworth and other people, very thinly disguised. And so anybody who knows film at all loves that movie because it's so inside. It's kind of like Sunset Boulevard and those kind of movies, the bad and the beautiful. Movies about movies, which to me have always been hypnotically interesting.
Yeah, but for me, I thought Ava Gardner was great, and I thought Humphrey Bogart was absolutely perfect, in my estimation.
Whereas, as
you say, in Sabrina Fair, he was a fish out of water.
Well, he hated the whole idea of playing a man in a Homburg. And for some reason, first of all, it's that seamed, alcoholic, smoking face.
Yeah.
It just didn't work with Audrey Hepburn. You know, strangely enough, it does with Lauren Bacall, but it didn't with Audrey Hepburn. There was no magic at all in there. And I think he couldn't wait to leave the set.
Wonderful story about Lauren Bacall. Afterwards, someone saying to her, "You're at the top, it'll never be this good again."
Well, she felt that was in a way correct, because her next film, she played a British heiress. She couldn't do an English accent, and she was terrible in it, and she knew she was terrible. It took her a while to find her feet without Bogart. Of course, with the two of them, there's always that sexual smolder, and that works on screen, and it worked so well in black and white. That's another thing. People forget that these great actors were established in black and white.
Yeah.
And John Huston said, if you met Humphrey on the street, you'd think, a nice-looking man, but nothing that distinguished. Get him in front of those lights, black and white, he turned into a hero. Something wonderful happened.
No. There's another side to Humphrey Bogart's life, and it's here.
Yes, that's the committee against another committee. The other committee is the House Un-American Activities Committee, which came to Hollywood to find Reds, so-called, people with communist sympathies. This was in the middle of the Red Scare in the 50s. And clearly they were there to grab headlines. And Humphrey Bogart originally was one of the biggest stars opposing them. But when the Hollywood 19 began to put on their show against the House Un-American Activities Committee, it was Billy Wilder who said, they called the unfriendly 19. Some of them are talented, the rest are just unfriendly. and the fact is that began to manipulate the court, and some of them were communists and didn't say they were. They had lied to their lawyer, and he said, I'm not going to be pushed around by the left, even though he was a traditional Roosevelt liberal. He didn't like to be pushed around by anybody, whether it was Jack Warner or John Huston, or the committee, or Congress, or these communists. And so I think he just dropped out of it. And people resented him, like Paul Henri would never talk to him after that. People resented him. But I think he was looking for his career, and I think he was also a person who felt no good was going to come of this for him.
Yeah. When you say about nobody pushed him around, I had the feeling reading it, and knowing Jack Warner, when he put Humphrey on suspension, he may have been bitching about it at home, etc., but he always gave in, really.
Yes, he did. I think he knew, for one thing, the Warner Studio was interested in the kind of underdog roles that he liked to play. They were not MGM with romantic roles. Yeah. They were, and they didn't make musicals. You know, Bogart couldn't dance, he couldn't sing, but he did something that no one else could do. He crystallized an American feeling at the time, whether it was the toughness of the hard-boiled detective, whether it was the man who was going to go off in the end in Casablanca and fight the war, and meaning that the United States was no longer going to be in the hands of isolationists. All of those things, whether later on he did Captain Queeg and made him a sympathetic person, even though there was a mutiny against him. All of those things, I think he needed